Tracy Reimer.
And I'm Kathy Davini.
And we're here with your Bradley Beat. And yesterday, boy, didn't we have fun at the Downtown Dine Around.
Downtown Dine Around, such a huge success as always. It's so much fun to get to sample and try foods, especially from places that you haven't been before.
Yes, yeah. And so it's great to walk around and, I mean, I eat downtown all the time.
I'm I do too.
You know, like I'm a big small business supporter. I'd always much rather shop local than visit a chain restaurant. And we have so many great options in downtown Cleveland to do that. So,
well, and it's fun to be downtown and walk around.
It is.
Especially this time of year.
Especially this time of year. Mm-hmm. So we were happy to take part in that. And then, of course, last weekend was a big weekend.
It was a big weekend. The blueprints.
Botanical blueprints at the museum. So that was, we had a good crowd for that. And everybody loved learning how to cyanotype.
And you didn't cyanotype.
Unfortunately, I could not
Mary
be there.
Ollie, but
Mary Ollie cyanotyped.
Yeah.
So now she can tell us about how to do that. And that's, you know, what I love so much about this guest artist series that we have is we do have the artist usually from our gift shop, and they are coming in and they are teaching us how to do their specific art medium. So you really do get a good lesson and learn a new skill. And it's a fun way to explore your creative side. Mm-hmm. And just something different to do on a Saturday morning. So
it's always fun to learn something different.
It is. Mm-hmm. It is. So we're going to be taking a little bit of a break during the summer.
Well, you have all those camps.
We have summer camps all summer long, and we're
That's
tired.
That's not a break.
It's not really a break. Anyways, you know, people travel so much in the summer. So we're taking a break for June and July, but then our guest artist series should start back up in August. So we're excited. We're going to have a cupcake decorating class.
Oh, that's going to be so fun.
Wendy from Cupcake Divas is mm-hmm. going to come, and she is going to do that. It's going to be great. But I do want to take just a minute and talk about our summer camps. Thank you for pulling that out. Registration is open on our website at www.museumcenter.org. And we have some amazing summer camps this year. Of course, we've got Missoula Children's Theater coming in. We can take up to 60 children ages.
That's great that you can take so many.
Yep.
Because in the art classes, they're
it's
smaller.
Not as many. They're much smaller. Mm-hmm. But this is ages first grade, rising first graders through 12th grade. So a huge age range. Missoula Children's Theater is coming in. They actually bring professional directors. And throughout the week, we will hold auditions on Monday. And then throughout the week, we will produce a play. It's going to be The Frog Prince. And so there are roles for, you know, different age ranges. So if you're, you know, in high school and you're like, I'm too old for summer camps, well, I kind of need you not to be. especially if you want to,
this is
you know,
a
if
great,
you love theater.
Great opportunity.
This is a great opportunity.
And if you don't know that you love theater, you yeah. might be able to be exposed to this and find yeah. out whether or not you do or don't love theater.
Right. So we can take up to 60 kids. You don't have to actually register for that. You can show up for the open audition on July 18th. However, it's great if you register just so we know what to expect, but it is a totally free camp. So parents out there, if you're listening to this, this is a free week-long summer camp for your kids. You're not going to find that anywhere else. We also have the Creative Discovery Museum is coming to Cleveland to partner with the Museum Center at Five Points.
I think that's great.
To put on a STEAM camp, and it's called Click It, Lock It, Blow It Up. And it's their curriculum, their staff, they're bringing everything. So if you're like, gosh, I really wish we had a science museum in Cleveland that my kids could go and play at and do summer camp at. Well, guess what? We do. It's the Museum and Cultural Center at Five Points. And that camp is July 11th through 15th. So please come out and register for it. We do have a few people have already started to register, but there's still spaces. We also have Curator Camp. It's the only the first time we've ever done this. And it's a two-week camp. The first week, you get to learn how to, like, research and do the art and design and exhibit. The second week, you actually build that exhibit, and it will be in our lobby display cases. So it is for older kids, ages 10 to 12, because it is a more intense camp. But we are so excited about it. The exhibit is going to be on historic properties. You'll be touring historic properties around downtown, going to the library and researching. You will be like, you know, taking our display cases apart and putting stuff back in them. It's going to be a great camp. We're excited about that.
This is a good camp for that age group because it's hard to find things for that age group. They feel like they're either too old or too young.
Too young, but this is just the right mix. And then, of course, we've got Bike Camp again, which we're partnering with Bike Walk Cleveland. Gina Simpson is wonderful. We're going to have a junior bike camp, and that's for kids that really don't know a lot about bikes. Like maybe they know how to ride, but they don't know about the parts of a bike and they need to learn bike safety, or maybe they're just learning how to ride. So we have a camp just for those young riders. And then we have an advanced bike camp as well. So these are your riders that know a little bit more. They feel good to go. And both of those come with like riding your bikes outside during the day, maybe a escorted trip down to the Blythe Oldfield Park. So we're very excited about that. So summer camps are open for registration. We do have a few spots left. So get on those while you can.
Well, while we're talking about upcoming adventures, mm-hmm. let's talk about the CASA 5K.
Yes.
So that is on the 14th. It is $20 starting mm-hmm. at 8 a.m. So if you are interested in doing a 5K, get your group together, go have a good time mm-hmm. and do that. Lend Me a Tenner starts May 14th. Mm-hmm. That's going to be really fun. That's at the venue Creekside.
Now, that's a one-man show, am I correct? Isn't that Jim Veenstra?
He's going to come talk to us,
not this week, but in a couple weeks.
We'll learn more about that show.
Mm-hmm. And we'll learn more about it then.
I've heard about this show before, but mm-hmm. I really don't know what it's about.
Yeah. Well, I know Jim Veenstra has a wonderful voice. We hear him sing with Sounds of Tennessee.
That's right.
And so I'm sure if he's involved, it's going to be great.
It's going to be a great mm-hmm. program. And then on the 20th, the band is back out at Riceville Remix. Okay. We had a group that did that last month. We had a group of 18 and just everybody's chair dancing and
having fun.
Dancing in front of the band.
It's a great time to go see a band.
It's just nice to be outside and be free and enjoy where we live and enjoy our friends. I mean,
absolutely.
That's what life is about.
Well, you know what else you can do outside? You can't necessarily be free while you're doing it.
Oh, I'm afraid to hear what.
You can shoot guns.
Oh, that's right. You can shoot guns. I was waiting.
You can shoot guns outside. We have today with us, we have Andy Walker, who is a sharpshooter.
I didn't know what you were coming out with. But Andy is an amazing and interesting young man, and I'm excited to learn about his sport. Because I totally was unaware of it.
Yes.
And hundreds of people are involved in this marksmanship sport that I was unaware of. Mm-hmm.
And Andy Walker is the current state champion. He is nationally ranked. So we are excited to have him on in just a few seconds. So we'll be right back.
We'll be right back with Andy Walker.
And we're back with Andy Walker, who's going to tell us a little bit about shooting guns.
That's right. Yeah. Shooting guns. That's what I like to do. No golf, yeah. Just shooting guns.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So I could go anywhere. Where do y'all want me to start on this?
Okay. So let's talk about how you are ranked in the state and ranked in the country and what they call your sport and how you got to that ranking.
Sure. So I guess to start off
no pressure.
Like your life story. If you could tell us your life story. Yeah.
As far as I guess me and where I am in the sport, I shoot USPSA, which is United States Practical Shooting Association. There's lots of different shooting sports under that action shooting sport umbrella, mm-hmm. but that's the one that I primarily, you know, compete in now. Mm-hmm. And so what they do is you'll have local matches, then you'll have state level matches, then you'll have area matches, and then you'll end up shooting, a national championship kind of towards the tail end of the year. That time frame can vary depending on what division you're shooting in. Mm-hmm. So There's different divisions that you compete in. And the one that I compete in right now is something called carry optics. So it's a production handgun that you can just buy off the shelf at any gun shop. And instead of having iron sights that you're looking through, it's got a red dot on top of it. And so that's become the most popular division in the sport. And so I'm the current state champion for carry optics. And then at the
last
at the last nationals that I shot in 2021, I got 40th in the country. So
That's amazing.
Yeah. So that's kind of where I'm at.
Yeah. And how did you get involved in this?
Sure. So I think just like anybody that gets a handgun for the first time, you know, I bought this thing. I started, shooting it a little bit at the range. And then I, eventually went and got my concealed carry license, right? And so I took the shooting test and took the, written portion of it. And, I got 100% on the shooting portion.
Great.
So I was like, my goodness, I'm a good shot. Like, I'm pretty good at this, right? And so, kind of down the road, we moved here to Cleveland from Memphis. And I got a membership at a local outdoor range here. And so I take my wife, Michelle, who's a much better shot at me than me at this point, by the way. And so we set up some water bottles at the range to shoot at. And I get my handgun out. And, I'm wanting to show off a little bit, like how good I am with this thing. I've just gotten 100% on my, class here. And so I end up, missing every single shot through this magazine. I'm looking over at her going, honey, this thing is obviously not sighted in. Like, something's wrong here. It can't be me. And so I was like, you can try it if you want, but don't expect. She ends up hitting every single one of these, the same gun, same ammo, same distance to the target, just absolutely crushing it.
Rock on, Michelle.
Yeah. So I'm feeling like completely humiliated at this point because I was the one supposed to be showing off
dating,
to her.
Right?
No, we're married at this point, fortunately. So she couldn't go anywhere after seeing that performance. But, it kind of drove me down that line of, okay, I've got this gun. I thought I was good with it. Mm-hmm. Turns out I wasn't. And so how do I get better? Mm-hmm. And so that kind of led me along this path of getting involved in the shooting sports. And I mean, if you are looking to shoot a gun, handgun, rifle, whatever it is, if you're looking to do it at a really high level and get proficient with it, there is nothing better than this. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now, if somebody wanted to get involved with it, say there's somebody that's just gotten a gun, how do they get involved with the sport?
So I think that the best way to do it is there's a website called practicescore.com. It's P-R-A-C-T-I score.com. And so what you can do is you can get on that website and you can plug in your zip code, or you can just pull up a map and do a little ping of where you are. Mm-hmm. And it's going to pull up all the different shooting sports that you can pick from. Mm-hmm. It's going to tell you when they are, where you go, who you can contact for more info. And I think that's probably the best way to do it. And then once you find out, which one you might be interested in or where it is, if your first time out, you don't want to actually shoot. You just kind of want to go watch and check it out. You can go and people are extremely helpful at these things. So you'll find a bunch of people that are more than happy to talk to you about it and explain it to you and kind of get you, where you need to be so you're ready for that first match.
Yeah. Now, I would imagine that this is a huge involvement of people. Mm-hmm. What kind of numbers of people are involved in this kind of activity?
So I would say that, depending on what sport you're shooting, at a local match, you're going to have, anywhere from 50 to 100 people.
That's a lot.
Just shooting.
That's a lot.
Once you get to those higher level matches, you're looking, at a state match, you're probably looking 200-300 people.
Wow.
And a nationals, it might be, 400 or 500, something like that. So quite a few people. It's a hobbyist sport. It's volunteer based for the majority of the people that are running these matches. They'll have to go to a range officer certification course. Mm-hmm. And so, that's the, the very first piece of this is to make sure that, you know, everybody's safe. They know what they're doing. And so you've got those ROs out there just making sure everything's running the way it's supposed to.
Now, do you have to qualify to go to some of these matches, or can anybody just sign up and go to whatever match?
Yeah, so great question. I think one of the coolest things about the sport is, you know, anybody, regardless of your skill level, I mean, I can't think of any other sport where, you know, you could go and shoot alongside, you know, Tiger Woods in a round of golf, or play basketball with LeBron James. But I mean, so there's a set amount of spots that are dedicated to these, you know, people that have won these different events. And then they have just open registration where anybody can just sign up and go shoot with these people.
That's
if you're
neat.
Lucky enough to get on their squad.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, I've been fortunate enough to get to shoot with world and national champions, like just right next to me. And so it's really cool for that. From that perspective.
Yeah. Now, what are you shooting at?
So I brought these. I was hoping you'd ask me about them. So these are just scaled 1/3 targets. And actually what I use these for is dry fire. And so, you know, there's 3 feet to a yard. And so I can set these up and just practice without any ammo and just kind of practice at those targets. But the gist of it is on these targets, there's different scoring zones.
Mm-hmm.
And the more accurate you are, the better it is for your total score.
Mm-hmm.
And so regardless of what sport you're shooting, it's always, you know, there's a time factor. So there will be a beeper to go off to indicate you start shooting. And then it records all the way up to that last audible shot that timer records. So you've got the time factor, and then you've got, you know, how accurate were your shots on those targets. And you'll shoot mostly cardboard, but something really cool that they do is there's a bunch of steel targets that you can shoot at. And you shoot them, they make a big loud ping, and then they fall over. And there is a wide array of different steel targets that you can shoot at, and it is just...
So that's
it's just
like
a world
of
fun.
Those games.
Yes, yes, that's exactly right. In fact, even in Chattanooga, they have actually created their own shooting sport. They call it Rimfire Falling Steel. And they've got these little tiny steel targets, and they're thin, so a .22 caliber is enough to knock them over. And, you know, there are kids and everybody coming out to these things, and all you do is you just shoot down the steel.
And do you use real bullets for those?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
But on this, you don't. What do you use?
Yeah, you use real bullets for all of it. So, yeah,
Well, I thought you said air shoot. What does that mean?
Oh, sorry. For the dry firing.
Dry fire.
Yeah.
No,
so,
I guess I came up with the air shoot.
Yeah. No, that's exactly what it is air shooting. Yeah, that's exactly right. So you can actually get really good, shooting a gun without actually firing any ammo.
But do you know that you've hit anything?
Great. Okay. So that's why I love that red dot I was telling you about.
Okay.
So the red dot on top of it, you know, used to with iron sights, you know, you're having to line everything up and it's like, you know, was that a good shot? You know, did I hit where I was wanting to? And unless you've had a whole lot of time behind the gun, it's really hard to tell where you hit it. But with that red dot, I mean, it's, you pull the trigger and you can see exactly where the bullet's going. So you can practice a whole lot doing that, just pulling the trigger, making sure that sight doesn't move and that, you know,
that sounds like
exactly where you want it to.
Great way to practice and not waste ammo.
Yes, and ammo is not getting any cheaper. So,
no.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've heard it's pretty expensive. So
I need to learn how to shoot a gun. I haven't done it. A lot of my friends have been after me because a lot of times I'm in places by myself and they're like, you really need protection. I'm like, my mouth is my protection. They're like, no, but that doesn't help you when somebody's got a weapon.
Yep. Yeah. It's funny you bring that up because I was actually shooting Area 6 a couple weekends ago, and there was a younger lady on my squad, and she was like really good. She was killing it. And I was like, you know, what in the world got you into doing this? And she was like, you know, I had something happen and, you know, it scared me. And I just felt like, you know, I needed to get this. And, you know, I didn't want to just get it to have. I wanted to, like, actually know how to use it. And man, she could use it. Like, she was really good with it. So, yeah.
That's amazing. Now, I know, do these targets, are they still when you're shooting or do they move around?
Awesome. So they stick them on, you know, wooden, you know, holders, and then they put them in different positions. And so you're always shooting something different. But the fun part about it is some of them, actually most of them are stationary. Mm-hmm. So you're just shooting at a stationary target. Mm-hmm. You might have to lean behind a wall or run up to it or whatever to get to it so you can shoot at it, but they're stationary. The steel I was telling you about, mm-hmm. it's awesome. They will rig it up where after you knock the steel down, mm-hmm. it'll set off what they call an activated target. And so it'll do anything from like swing like this where you're having to shoot at it to where it'll pop up and then another target will pop up in front of it. So you only have a limited amount of time to shoot at it. And it's just, I mean, the stuff they come up with is just awesome.
How fun. So,
yeah, fun.
It's something
like
different every time. Yeah.
Yeah. So I bet you've met some really interesting people through your travels and your competitions and probably just going to the range.
Yes, absolutely. So, I mean, I think the cool part about this is it attracts, you know, so many different people from so many different walks of life. You know, you've got school teachers all the way from like FBI guys that are doing this. You know, I've met guys from the Chattanooga SWAT team that are doing this.
Cool.
And so you just, I don't know, you just meet all sorts of really cool people that are out there, you know, interested and just getting good at shooting guns. Wow. So it's pretty neat.
Now, is there somewhere here in Cleveland that you can go and shoot? Is there a good community here or?
Absolutely. So, and that's another cool thing about the sport. You know, there are a lot of these outdoor ranges that, you know, it's member only and it's really hard to get access to them. But these places are, you know, kind enough to open their doors for the shooting sports. And so, you know, here in Cleveland, we've got the Cleveland Hunting Rifle and Pistol Club off of Lead Mine Valley Road. And, you know, if you'll get on that website I was telling you can see when their different events are being held. And, you know, you pay like $10 and you get to go, you know, have access to that range while they're doing these competitions.
So do you have to belong to these places to go and practice? Is that how that works?
Yep. You have to belong to them to go practice. But again, if they're having one of these shooting competitions, you can go just like anybody else can and shoot.
So are there places that you don't have to be a member to go and practice shooting, or no, you have to belong to all of them?
Yeah, unfortunately, unless you're fortunate enough to have your own property or somebody allowing you some, you know, access to that property, it's I think you're limited to kind of the indoor ranges. Sorry about that.
No. I had pulled something out to ask you about.
Oh, sure. And so, yeah, I think you got to pay to practice, essentially. Yeah.
So I saw this in the paper a while back, and I thought about you. Of course, this is from February.
Okay.
This is a rifle marksmanship clinic.
Okay.
Offered. So apparently, there are clinics that you can go to and learn about marksmanship.
Yeah. I mean, I would think so. I wouldn't know exactly where to, you know, direct people for the training. I would say that I would think, you know, maybe you can find it on the NRA website or something like that. And then, you know, you'd be shocked, kind of like I was telling you, you have access to these really high level shooters. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of these, you know, world and national championship guys, if you'll get in contact with them, they will run classes, you know, in your state. And, you know, you can get instruction from a top level guy for, you know, I don't know, $200-$300. So, I mean.
So did you go to any of these classes or did you strictly teach yourself based on your practice?
Yeah, I would say that, you know, in the technological age, I definitely learned a lot just through, you know, YouTube, uh-huh. social media, uh-huh. stuff like that. So I actually didn't take any training. It was just kind of all self-taught. But, you know, if you kind of know what to look for, you can certainly get a lot of, you know, good tidbits from these guys that are out there posting their stuff.
Well, and you might meet other friends along the way too.
Yeah. And I've had lots of mentors, along the way that have, you know, kind of helped me out and, you know, pointed things out that I needed to work on. And so it's just a really helpful community.
So have you seen this sport growing? How long have you been in it in this area? Can you see a growing trend in this?
Yeah, I would say it's certainly getting, more popular.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a lot of that has to do with just, you know, how much is posted on social media, right, and different stuff like that. And so
I didn't know about it until you told me about it.
Right. So, you know, it's kind of a, you know, I'd say it's still not mainstream. I think for most of those folks, like, you know, like I was saying earlier, they think, you know, you go to a gun, you get a gun, you go to an indoor range, you shoot at the, right, you know, the one target in front of you. And that's kind of, you know, it's kind of what there is.
And it seems like becoming very proficient in shooting is also really great for gun safety as well.
I would think so too.
Right. And that's exactly right. In fact, I actually wrote down, you know, just, you know, the rules of firearm safety and how the shooting sports, you know, implements those in your matches. So, mm-hmm, you know, first one is, you know, you always treat a gun like it's loaded. Second one is, you know, keep the muzzle pointed in a safe direction. So just on those two things, like when you go to a shooting match, every gun, unless you're the person that is like, it's your time to shoot, all those guns are unloaded. Mm-hmm. So there's no live guns on the range.
So they load when it's their turn to shoot.
The range officer will look and make sure the bay that you're shooting on is clear. And then they'll say a command, you know, range is clear. They'll tell you to go ahead and load and make ready. That's when you load your gun
That's
up, get ready to go. And then as soon as you're done shooting, they say unload, show clear. And so you'll show them a clear chamber. Hammer down, holster the gun back up, and that gun's completely safe. And next person, you know, you paste all your targets, mm-hmm, reset everything up, and then the next person gets to go.
Rules are really good in such a sport. I'll just say two more things. Because I'm an animal lover, I adore that you're shooting target.
Yeah. Unless you're cardboard or steel, you got nothing to worry about.
And secondly, we have a friend, Jeff Miller, that has always worked with our daughter on shooting because he's a big believer in you've got to know how to clean your gun. And our friend Jason Foster did the same thing. You have to clean your gun before you can shoot it. You have to know how to load your gun properly. And I know one of Jeff's rules is, you can't turn your head any direction your gun is not pointed. So if you're holding the gun, you can't look over here. You can only look the direction your gun is pointed.
Yep.
So yep. I've learned a few rules just from listening in, but that's kind of it.
Yeah. And in the shooting sports, we've got a 180 rule. So, you know, that gun, you know, is always pointed downrange no matter what. And so, you know, you got everybody that's kind of watching you do your thing, and the gun's always pointed down range, and it just makes for a completely safe, you know, environment to shoot, mm-hmm, in. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the way the bays are set up, you'll have, you know, berms set up all around you. So as long as you're shooting in that direction, you know, you don't have to worry about the bullet going off, you know, somewhere where it's not supposed to.
Yeah. That's great. Hasn't this been so interesting?
Thank you so much.
I appreciate you all having me. Thank you.
And telling us all about this. You know, and Kathy said, we're going to have a sharpshooter on. And I was like, well, what's he going to tell us about? You know?
I always learn so much.
I know.
From all of our guests. So we thank you so much for coming.
Thanks for having me.
Andy is a fabulous soccer player. He plays soccer with our men's group in town. And he mentioned this to me, and I thought, that is so interesting. I know absolutely nothing.
Yeah.
So if I can learn something, I feel like maybe
we all can. Maybe we all can. Well, thank you so much, Andy, for coming and telling us all about your sport.
Thank you.
We will have to come back. Maybe one day they'll let us out of the radio station and Andy can actually show us how.
I don't think anybody would ever give me a gun.
I would love to take you all the range. You just let me know.
That would be so much fun. Well, thank you so much for joining us, and we hope to see you next time.
Thanks for supporting us on the Bradley Beat.
See you next time.
Yeah.